And let's open our lesson. Slide number 2. I want to review where we're at in our study of the sanctuary. We started out with a lesson entitled Redemption in the Sanctuary. That's the broad aspects of the sanctuary and how it refers and reveals the redemptive process. Then we talked about the great need for the book of Hebrews to the early church, because they were looking for Jesus to return and he hadn't come, and another decade passed and he hadn't come, and Paul wanted them to understand what was really happening in the heavens and for them to be patient because a work was going on in heaven. Then we talked about the sacrificial system, the tabernacle and its furnishings, Aaron as high priest, then Jesus as high priest. We also spoke and discussed and learned about the consecration of Aaron and his sons, the investigative judgment. We spent a great deal of time on that. And we spent 3 lessons on the Day of Atonement, part 1, part 2, and conclusion. And then we moved to that famous verse that is the foundation of our faith, so to speak, unto 2,300 days. And that's where we want to pick up today and complete that part. So let's look at Daniel 8. Now, if you'll open your Bibles to Daniel 8, we're going to read some things in here. But to give you an overview, Daniel 8 starts off with a very important prophecy. And here, by the bullets, are some of the important parts of that. A ram with 2 horns, one higher than the other. And the 2 horns, we are told, are the kings of Media and Persia. We also see a he-goat that had a notable horn between its eyes, which was broken, and 4 notable ones came up in its place. The he-goat is the king of Grecia, and the great horn is the first king, Alexander the Great. And the 4 horns are the 4 divisions of the Greek Empire after Alexander's death. And out of one of these horns came a little horn. Next slide. And then we are told in this particular chapter about the little horn. The horn became exceeding great. It destroys wonderfully the people of God, verse 24. But not by war, but by peace, we are told in verse 25. This little horn is wise, crafty, and has a definite policy, we read in verse 25. It is powerful, but not by its own power. And we are told it would prosper and practice. Next slide. It is a proud power. And these points I gleaned from Andresen's book, The Sanctuary Service. It's a proud power, he tells us. And the reason he says that is because the Bible tells us he shall magnify himself in his heart, even to the prince of the host. That's verses 25 and 11. It's also, this little horn power, a persecuting power, for it destroys the mighty and the holy people, and a host is given him to be trodden underfoot, verses 24, 10, 12, and 13. It also teaches false doctrine, for it casts down the truth to the ground, in verse 12 we are told. And it wars against the truth. We know that because it casts it down. It trodens it down, so to speak. And Andresen says, the sanctuary is cast down and trodden underfoot. But we're going to look at that phrase in a minute. But that's how he understands it. But he says, and the Bible says, that this little horn power is broken without hand. Let's look at the next slide. And in verse 27, we are told that Daniel saw all of this in vision, and it so affected him that he fainted and was sick certain days. He was astonished at the vision, and neither he nor anyone else could understand it. Next slide. Then on page 285, Andresen says, we are especially interested in the time mentioned in verse 14. The conversation carried on between the two angels was evidently for Daniel's benefit and our benefit, of course. The vision of the ram and the he-goat seems to be related merely to lead up to the story of the little horn that became exceeding great. Next slide. Continuing on, Andresen says, when Daniel saw the persecutions carried on by this power and how it would prosper by crafty methods and magnify itself and destroy wonderfully, he naturally wondered how long this would continue. In the conversation of the angels, he is told that there is to be a period of 2300 days, during which time both the sanctuary and the host is to be trodden underfoot, and this evil power will prosper and even affront the prince of hosts. How could this be? How could this power be mighty and not by his own power? That seems a contradiction in terms, Andresen says. How could it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground and stamp on them? How could it cast down the sanctuary and tread it underfoot? How could it cast down the truth to the ground and prosper in so doing? Yet all of this it was to do, and Daniel was astonished. But he was more than astonished. When he saw what this power would do to the sanctuary, to religion, to God's people, to truth, he was sick certain days. Here was a blasphemous power that would persecute God's people and attempt to destroy the truth and prosper in so doing. Daniel 8:11 says, yea, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host, and by him the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. Now, this verse has some important information in it. The first part, the daily sacrifice, we are not going to address, and in the on slide 15, it explains why. I have words, Ellen White says, from First Selected Messages, page 167. I have words to speak to all who have been active in urging their views in regard to the meaning of the daily of Daniel 8. This is not to be made a test question, and the agitation that has resulted from its being treated as such has been very unfortunate. Confusion has resulted, and the minds of some of our brethren have been diverted from the thoughtful consideration that should have been given to the work the Lord has directed should be done at this time in our cities. This has been pleasing to the great enemy of our work. Going on. The light on the next slide. The light given me is that nothing should be done to increase the agitation upon this question. Let it not be brought into our discourses and dwelt upon as a matter of great importance. We have a great work before us, and we have not an hour to lose from the essential work to be done. I would bring to your attention the last prayer of Christ as recorded in John 17. There are many subjects upon which we can speak, sacred, testing truths, beautiful in their simplicity. On these you may dwell with intense earnestness. But let not the daily or any other subject that would arouse controversy among brethren be brought in at this time, for this will delay and hinder the work the Lord would have the minds of our brethren centered upon just now. Now, we can all individually study this, yes. We can talk to one another, yes. But I don't wish to teach anything about the daily following this counsel, that it would cause confusion, perhaps, because there are different ways of looking at that, the Seventh-day Adventist Bible commentary being one, for example. But let's look at this verse at the second part, the latter half of Daniel 8:11, where it says, "And the place of his sanctuary was cast down." Now remember, when Andreessen uses this, he says the sanctuary is cast down, but really the Bible is telling us the place of his sanctuary. Now what does this mean, the place? The Hebrew word on the next slide explains it can be used in two different ways. It can be a place, a literal place, especially the dwelling place of God. So either Daniel 8:11 is saying the dwelling place of God is cast down, and we know that the Shekinah glory was in the sanctuary. So some people have taken this literally to understand that when the Romans came in AD 70 and destroyed the temple, that the tabernacle, the place of God's dwelling, was cast down. But consider that there were centuries prior to that and centuries after that that this may not be, this literal understanding may not be applicable to. But there's a second way this Hebrew word is used, and it means foundation. The place that we put our faith, for example, the foundation of the sanctuary, or the basis of the sanctuary. And I'm just asking you to consider this also, that the foundation of the sanctuary, whatever that is, we haven't discussed it today, right now, that it might be cast down. But let's go on. In evangelism, on the next slide, we read on page 221, the correct understanding of the ministration of the heavenly sanctuary is the foundation of our faith. We could say, in another way, the correct understanding of the ministration of the heavenly sanctuary is the place of our faith, where our faith is placed, where it's put, so to speak. Let's go on, next slide. Andreessen says on page 286 of his book, The Sanctuary Service, even the sanctuary, he says, would be cast down and trodden underfoot. But let's read in 8:11 again. It tells us that the place of his sanctuary, whatever that is, and I'm not here to say it's one way or another. It could be the literal place, or it could be the foundation, the what makes the foundation of that sanctuary, is cast down and trodden underfoot. Continuing in Andreessen's book, the one ray of hope, and I've read this before, and the whole vision concerned time. The sanctuary and the truth would not always be trodden underfoot. The truth would come again into its own again. It would be vindicated at the end of the 2300 days. The sanctuary would be cleansed. To that time, God's people were to look. Now on the next slide. But contemplating this time frame brought no comfort to Daniel because he didn't understand it. What did 2300 days mean? When did it begin? When would it end? Do you know when it begins? And do you know how to determine when it begins? The Bible doesn't tell us here in Daniel 8. It just says unto 2300 days. Now, on the next slide, I have written that about 12 years later, Daniel got the answer to all of these questionings, these things he didn't understand. Some people say, I've read different time frames, but several years later. So he went through a time where he didn't understand this. And even my reading last night in the SDA Bible commentary on Daniel 9, when he's praying, the commentary brings out that he's thinking, okay, 70 years are up for my people. Is God going to make this a longer period of time? And the reason it's, one of the reason it says that, let's look in Daniel 9. Let's see if I can find it in his prayer. Oh, here it is in verse 19. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive, Daniel is praying. O Lord, hearken and do. Defer not. And the Bible commentary is saying he's worried that God's going to defer this period of time, and maybe to a long period of time, and it really worried Daniel, according to the commentary. But the 70-week prophecy helps us understand when the 2300 days begin. Let's read first in Daniel 9:23. At the beginning of thy supplications, the commandment came forth, and I am come to show thee, for thou art greatly beloved. And therefore, understand the matter and consider the vision. So, after several years, Daniel is praying and he's asking for God to not defer his promise to the people of Israel. And an angel comes. And verse 21 says it was Gabriel that came. And he came to give him an answer. And the answer and understanding he came to give concerned the vision. Now let's move on to the next slide. Gabriel is saying to Daniel, consider the vision. What vision? The Hebrew word used for vision here is mara. In Daniel 8, the prophet says in verse 2 that he saw a vision. And the Hebrew word Daniel used for vision in Daniel 8:2 is shazon. This is the same word translated vision in verses 13, 15, 17, and in the latter part of Daniel 8:27. But there is another Hebrew word that is translated vision in chapter 8, and that word is the one we just learned about, mara. It is used in verses of Daniel 8, 16, Daniel 8, 26, and the first part of Daniel 8, 27. While both of these words can be translated vision, Daniel chose to use two different words. Shazon is used to speak of the vision as a whole that he saw. But when specifically speaking of the 2300 evenings and mornings, he used the word mara. And so when Gabriel comes back after a certain number of years to give Daniel skill and understanding, he came back to give him skill and understanding about the mara. Next slide. The only part of the shazon that Gabriel did not explain earlier on was the 2300 days, because if you will look back in Daniel 8, starting in verse 8, you read about the horn that waxed very great, it was broken, and out of one of them in verse 9 came a little horn, and then we read all the characteristics of that little horn. It waxed great, it cast down, it magnified, etc. And later, the angel over in the same chapter explains to Daniel what he had seen in vision. For example, the verse 20 says, the ram which thou sawest, having two horns, are the kings of Media and Persia. And he goes on to give him the explanation of the vision. But the one thing he didn't explain at that time was the 2300 days. And this is what puzzled Daniel. This is what he was sick and faint over. He didn't understand this part. Several years later, Gabriel comes back to give him understanding of that particular part, the mara. Let's look at slide 28. Understanding Daniel's use of shazom and mara is necessary to understand the 2300 days of prophecy, or the 2300 literal years of time. Gabriel says that 70 years are determined, and you read that in next, we're in chapter 9 in verse 24. 70 weeks are determined. That Hebrew word means literally to cut off. In other words, 70 weeks are years are cut off. And the only thing from which they can be cut off are those 2300 days. 70 weeks are the same as 490 days. Remember that each day of symbolic biblical prophecy represents a year of literal time. Thus, the 70 weeks equals 490 literal years. Next slide. I'll just read this and hopefully it will make sense to you, and we're going to look at some charts in a minute. But the total number of weeks given in the breakdown is 7, 62, and 1. You add those together and you get your 70 weeks. The time for the first section of the 2300-day year prophecy is 70 weeks or 490 day years. This time was to begin with the decree to rebuild Jerusalem. This decree can be found word for word beginning in Ezra 7:12. And Ezra 7:7 informs us that this decree went forth in the seventh year of Artaxerxes. The seventh year of King Artaxerxes of Persia was 457 BC, a date that some Bibles put in their margins. This is the starting date of the Mara. Let's go on to the next slide. Returning to the 2300 years now, we can find its ending point by simply subtracting the 490 from 2300 and adding that number to 34, the year the 70th week ended. The difference between 2300 and 490 is 1810, which is added to 34, the year AD 34, and it brings us precisely to the year AD 1844, exactly October 22 to be exact, to be precise, I mean. And so there, let's look at the next slide. We'll see this graph, this empty graph of an arc of 2300 days, but there's no starting point and no ending point. But based on what Gabriel tells Daniel in recorded in chapter 9, that 70 weeks are determined or are cut off from this long, the longest time prophecy in the Bible, and there is no other time prophecy longer than this, Ellen White tells us, they are cut off, or they are taken away from this long prophecy. So they are taken away and end up at the death, the stoning of Stephen in AD 34. Those are our 70 weeks, and then we have to add more to get to complete the 2300 days. And we'll just go through the next slide. It's a little more detailed. It shows Christ's baptism in AD 27, and then Stephen is stoned in AD 34. Next slide. And in the midst of that week there, after he is baptized and before he dies, he dies. Jesus is cut off, so to speak, or during the midst of the week. And then the last slide adds the 1810 years and gets us to 1844. So that, brothers and sisters, is how we determine when the 2300 days starts. It's cut off from, the 70-week prophecy is cut off from that long prophecy of 2300 days. They both start together. One part ends here and it continues on and ends in 1844. Now let's consider. We're going to go back to where we left off with Ezekiel 9. And to review, let's look at Ezekiel 9 verses 4 through 6. Because this is important when we think about the cleansing of the sanctuary. Ezekiel 9, starting in verse 4. And the Lord said unto him, to this mighty angel, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And to the others he said in mine hearing, go ye after him through the city and smite. Let not your eyes spare, neither Have ye pity, slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children, and women, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house. We are told in Testimonies to Ministers and Gospel Workers on page 444, the angels of God do his bidding, holding back the winds of the earth, that the winds should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree, until the servants of God should be sealed in the forehead. The mighty angel is seen ascending from the east, or sunrising, and that's where we read in Revelation. It's Revelation 7, 1 through 4. And after these things I heard four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And then verse 4 tells us the number of those sealed, the 144,000. This mightiest of angel has in his hand the seal of the living God, or of him who alone can give life, who can inscribe upon the foreheads the mark or inscription, to whom shall be granted immortality, eternal life. It is the voice of this highest angel that had authority to command the four angels to keep in check the four winds until this work was performed, and until he should give the summons to let them loose. Continuing on, those that overcome the world, the flesh and the devil, will be the favored ones who shall receive the seal of the living God. Those whose hands are not clean, whose hearts are not pure, will not have the seal of the living God. Those who are planning sin and acting it will be passed by. This sealing of the servants of God in Revelation 7:3 is the same that was shown to Ezekiel in vision. John also had been a witness of this most startling revelation. He saw the sea and the waves roaring and men's hearts failing them for fear. He beheld the earth moved, and the mountains carried into the midst of the sea, which is literally taking place, the water thereof roaring and troubled, and the mountains shaking with the swelling thereof. He was shown plagues, pestilence, famine, and death performing their terrible mission. And the reason I bring this up is because in Ezekiel, this sealing starts in the sanctuary, starts with the Ancient of Men. And that is going on. We're not in the cases of the living yet, but we do not know how soon our case will come up before the Ancient of Days, with our Savior and Elder Brother pleading our case, if it's possible to plead our case against Satan, so that we can be sealed. And the sealing that takes place in Revelation 7:3 is the same that's being referred to in Ezekiel 9. And we know that after the sealing, Revelation talks about the seven last plagues are poured out. There is a terrible time. Mountains or islands, things are in nature are convulsed, going, we might say, crazy, because of the time that is being represented, the great and terrible day of the Lord. And we now have a safety. I mentioned last week, Ellen White tells us, this probationary time is a time of safety for us, if we will use it to cleanse ourselves, to cooperate with God in cleansing ourselves of our sins, so that we will be worthy to be sealed and saved. Next slide, and it's the last slide. And And this is from the newly released letters and manuscripts of the Ellen White estate. And it's just a nice picture of what's going on now. Angels are belting the world, refusing Satan his claim to supremacy, made because of the vast multitudes of his adherents. We hear not the voices, we see not with the natural sight the work of these angels. But their hands are linked around about the world, and with sleepless vigilance they are keeping the armies of Satan at bay till the sealing of God's people shall be accomplished. There's a great work going on that we cannot see. But if we are safe with God, if we are doing our part, working with God to become overcomers, and He will give us the power to do this. I read last night that sanctification, there was a nice one-liner, I wish I'd kept it, but basically Ellen White tells us sanctification is seen in the daily things we do each day. It's not when that great test comes that we can show that we've been sanctified. It's in the daily things we participate, how we react to those trials and troubles that are sure to come. They're promised to come. And so whether it's you're under pressure to get somewhere on time and you have a lot to do before that, God will give you the power and the energy and the time to get it all done without complaining or murmuring or causing discomfort to other people. You know, we may have children that are not following God. I know I do. I have a daughter that loves the Lord. But my son, who's very intelligent, I should say, but he somehow has lost sight of the great work God can do for him and make his life so much easier than facing all the troubles and struggles that are out there alone, so to speak. I remember with sadness, one little member of my family, when she was three, was faced with the fact that she had to leave. Her parents were taking her away. But she looked at me and said, "You can come with us, can't you?" She saw something of goodness in me, not because of me, but because of what God can do in our lives, that she didn't want to be separated from. And then I saw the same thing not too long ago with another little child. "You can come with us, can't you?" These little children are sensitive to the hardships of Satan through the adults in their lives, but they're also sensitive to the goodness of God through our lives also. So let us walk daily in the goodness of God and trusting Him, no matter what comes, to keep us kind and loving and trusting and showing that to the little ones around us. And I didn't get to our story, maybe next time, but it's time for us to close. And I want to thank you for joining us. And let's kneel and ask God to bless the remainder of our day. Father, any goodness that we have comes as a gift from You. And we return that goodness to You by sharing it with others. So this circle of beneficence starts with You and returns to You. It's such a beautiful circle. Please, Father, fix us. Help us during this time of relative safety for Your people. Help us to overcome just as Jesus overcame. Help us to be like Him. Cleanse us from our sinful desires, from our habits that are not good, Lord, that You cannot honor, so that when the time comes and You're looking for a people of 144,000 that will honor You and say, regardless of what we walk through, You are worthy of our trust. And You are worthy of our worship. So Bring us to that point, I pray. Bless each one who's listening. May their hearts be unshaken as the hills and stable as the mountains about us, so that we will not walk away from you when that great crisis comes. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you once again for joining us. May God bless you. And until we meet again, may He keep you in the palm of His hand.